The concept of a boundary layer is very important to the study of aerodynamics. So let's just look at an object moving through the air. We'll cut a wing and just look at kind of an airfoil section, and it's moving through the air. So this is the free stream velocity. And what happens on the surface all along the surface of this geometry is that what we have, it's called a no-slip boundary condition. And what that means is that the air actually touching the wing is moving with the wing. So if you were to get close enough to that surface, you'd find that the air molecules that are actually touching that surface are moving with the surface. And so let's zoom in on that for a second and look at what the velocity looks like. Let's just set up a coordinate system here where y is our distance away from the surface. And we've got this free stream velocity coming in here. And we can look at this region in here and look at the what the velocity looks like as we get really close to that surface. So as we move far away from the surface, the velocity is going to be back to the free stream velocity. We usually label that with V infinity. So these guys up here, the velocity vectors up there will have a magnitude of V infinity. But really close to the surface down here, the velocity goes to zero, and right at the surface it goes actually to zero. And the reason for this is because of viscosity in the air. Viscosity is this measure of the tendency of a particle to stick to its neighbor. And so you can imagine that if the particles right on the surface are actually moving with the object, and the particles out in the free stream are moving at free stream velocity, well, there's a lot of shear between those two, where a particle between those two is getting pulled on the upper side by the velocity or the particles that are going faster, and below it it's slowing down because of the particles beneath it that are actually moving with the object itself, and so that causes this gradient in velocity. Now we can look at the we can use the gradient here right at the wall. I'm just going to draw a line here that's kind of tangent right at the wall there. And that line, if we know the slope of that line as it approaches the wall, that tells us actually the shear stress on the object itself. So we usually call that tau at the wall. That's the shear stress at the wall is equal to the viscosity of the fluid times du dy. Du dy, where u is the velocity, tangential to the wall, and y is this coordinate off of the wall. So basically du dy is the slope of this line here, and then we take the slope of that line, or the change in velocity as we move off of the wall, multiply it by mu, which is the viscosity of the fluid, and that tells us tau at the wall. Tau at the wall is what we call a shear stress. And we can integrate the shear stress along the surface of this geometry, and it tells us how much friction basically we have to overcome relative to the surrounding fluid to push this object through the air. So shear stress is a large contributor to drag, to the drag force that's opposing our motion. Now at high Reynolds numbers, and let's just write out what Reynolds number here is defined at. It's rho V L divided by mu. Rho is the density of the fluid. So that's density. And then we have velocity. And then L is just a length that this is operating over, or the length of our object. So for example, it'd be that like the cord of the wing, you know, so we'd use like this length here would be the length of that wing, for example. And then mu is the viscosity of the fluid. So what the Reynolds number is a non-dimensional value that tells us basically the ratio of the pressure forces, which are the top part here. These are the pressure forces to the viscous forces in a problem. And we'll talk more about Reynolds number. It's really important when we come to different trends for drag and lift. But what's important here is that at low Reynolds numbers, so at low Reynolds numbers, essentially that's when our velocity or our aircraft is at low speed, so velocity is small, then our boundary layer gets larger. Now the boundary layer is we've got to define our boundary layer here, and a common definition of that is the thickness. We can just kind of put a dashed line through here. It's the thickness when that velocity returns back to about 99% of the free stream velocity. And if you look at that on an object, let's just draw another airfoil down here. If we look at what that thickness is, that boundary layer is actually quite a small layer just along the outer surface of that object. So outside of this, boundary layer, the velocity is nearly equal to the free stream velocity, or also in that region, viscosity is almost negligible to the properties of the fluid. But inside the boundary layer, and I'll just kind of shade it in here, in this region here where the velocity is affected by the presence of that object, or significantly affected by the presence of that object, I should say, that's where viscosity is dominant. The effects of viscosity are very important, and what we're happening or what we're seeing there is this velocity gradient inside of the boundary layer. So computationally and analytically, this is a really helpful thing to understand, and this has been demonstrated by computational results as well as a lot of experimental results. I mean, there's tons and tons of data out there that shows this phenomenon. And this is really helpful because it allows us to kind of divide up the domain in this problem, where inside the boundary layer here, we have to account for viscosity, and viscous terms become very important. Also in that layer though, the flow is a little bit more two-dimensional, and so we can solve it using what are called the boundary layer equations, where we assume that gradients in one direction are much smaller than gradients in another direction, and we'll get into that more later as well. But anyway, it kind of simplifies down. So there's a set of equations that we can use in the boundary layer where these viscous terms are really important. And then outside of that, this is outside of the boundary layer, then viscous terms are nearly negligible. The viscosity does not significantly affect the fluid flow. And because of that, we can simplify the fluid equations outside of that, drop the viscosity terms, and come up with what are called the Euler equations. And those Euler equations basically neglect viscosity, but they're much simpler to solve. Once we drop the Euler equations out of the fluid flow equations, once we drop the viscosity out of the fluid flow equations, then those equations are much simpler to solve and actually lend well to different methods of solutions that simplify the problem significantly. So this is the concept of a boundary layer, that that in general, we have this region very close to the object where viscous terms dominate. And the flow, you see this gradient in the flow where as we approach the wall, the velocity goes to zero because it's attached to the wall. We can estimate the shear stress by knowing what that slope is as we approach the wall. And that's going to help us estimate what the drag is on this geometry. But then outside of the boundary layer, once we get to this cutoff point where we've returned back to about 99% the free stream velocity, outside of that, we can kind of neglect viscosity because it doesn't play a major role in the fluid motion. Okay, let's talk about one more thing here with the boundary layer. The boundary layer also creates something that's called stall. So let's plot, for example, as a function of angle of attack. So that's alpha, that's angle of attack. And the angle of attack is basically the angle that this free stream velocity is coming into the geometry, you know, relative to the coordinate system of this geometry. So we call that the angle of attack. And then we can look at the lift as a function of angle of attack. Now, what happens is at small angles, the lift is nearly linear with angle of attack. So as we increase the angle, as we increase the angle that this object is hitting the free stream, will increase the lift. But if we get to too large of an angle, so let me draw this object over here. So here's our airfoil or our wing, and here's the free stream velocity, and this is the angle of attack. So if we get at too large of an angle, what happens is the fluid flow on the upper surface it is moving very rapidly around this leading edge here. And what happens is if we get too large of an angle, it doesn't have enough energy to stay attached to the surface, and it will actually detach from the surface. So this fluid that's coming around, and then the same on the backside. Now it always exits there at the trailing edge, and we'll talk more about that in the future. But on the upper surface, if we get to too large of an angle of attack, that flow will separate. And what happens is then the pressure in this region it increases the pressure there. And so what happens then is that the lift will drop off at high angles of attack. And this is what we call stall. So if you get at too high of an angle of attack, that flow can't stay attached to the surface, and so the wing will stall. And this this maximum value, the maximum value of lift, is very important in many aspects of aircraft design because it affects things such as our takeoff and landing speeds, it affects our turning radius, it affects a lot of the performance of the aircraft, you know, the maximum amount of lift that you can generate. And so stall has been studied in great detail. We won't spend a whole lot of time on it in this course. We're actually going to spend most of our time studying the aerodynamics below stall and optimizing things below stall. But stall is very important to understand, and especially that maximum lift, being able to predict that, because that is directly related to the performance of the aircraft.